Good morning and welcome to St. David's. I'm Daryl Butler, longtime parishioner and retired auto genius who now flunking retirement. We are so glad you're here this morning. Please turn to your neighbor and ask them if you like to drink your cider hot, cold, or not at all, or even mixed with something. There was a lot happening this week at St. David's. Yesterday, our summer gun disposal came to a close. About 25 volunteers, many from our parish, helped the community around St. Aidan's Episcopal Church in Ann Arbor. We took in dozens of unwanted guns from the community and made them into artwork. That brings our total number of destroyed guns to 334 this summer. Father Chris will give us an overview presentation of the 2024 campaign and our Connection Hour on November 24th. Great work, team. Meanwhile, today marks the first Sunday of our annual pledge drive. If you received your pledge packet in the mail and would like to bring your 2025 pledge up to the altar, you can do it in a minute during our prelude. If you have not received a pledge packet, there are some in the back table in the narthex. Or your mailman just may be slow. Either way, we will be receiving pledges for the next day. We will be receiving pledges for the next today and on the next two Sundays. So feel free to bring your pledge then. In honor of Veterans Day, we want to thank Steve Bancroft and Jim Kinney, our flag bearers today. If you're joining us on Zoom, please feel free to share your prayer request via our chat box and click on the link there on our Sunday bulletin to follow along. If you are new here, we want to welcome you. Please stop by the Ministry Hub and sign our welcome book. Or if you're online, please mention this in the chat box so we can properly welcome you. Once again, welcome to our parish family. We are delighted to have you and excited for what God has planned for us this morning.
Thank you. O God, shed your grace upon us.
Is from the Hebrew scriptures in the book of Ruth and tells of the love and faithfulness of Naomi to her widowed daughter-in-law. Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to Ruth, "My daughter, I need to seek some security for you so that it may be well with you. Now here is our kinsman Boaz, with whom young women you have been working. See, he is a winnowing barley tonight on the threshing floor. Now wash and anoint yourself and put on your best clothes and go down to the threshing floor. But do not make yourself known to the man until he has finished eating and drinking. When he lies down, observe the place where he lies. Then go and uncover his feet and lie down, and he will tell you what to do." She said to her, "All that you tell me, I will do." So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. When they came together, the Lord made her conceive, and she bore a son. Then the woman said to Naomi, "Blessed be the Lord, who has not left you this day without next of kin, and may his name be renowned in Israel. He shall be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age, for your Naomi took the child. For your daughter-in-law, who loves you, is more to you than seven sons, has borne him. Then Naomi took the child and laid her in her bosom and became his nurse. The women of the neighborhood gave him a name, saying, "A son has been born to Naomi," and they named him Obed. He became the father of Jesse, the father of David. May your word dwell in us.
And bear much fruit to your glory.
Lesson is from the Christian scriptures in the book of Hebrews. Here we see how much God loves us by sending us Jesus. Christ did not enter a sanctuary made by human hands, a mere copy of the true one, but he entered into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God in our behalf. Nor was it to offer himself again and again, as the high priest enters the holy place year after year, with blood that is not his own. For then he would have had to suffer again and again since the foundation of the world. But as it is, he has appeared once for all the end of the age to remove sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is appointed for mortals to die once, and after that, the judgment, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly awaiting for him. May your word dwell in us.
And bear much fruit to your glory.
Thank you. Jesus says, beware of the scribes, like walk around long roads, and be greeted with respect in the marketplaces, to have the best seats in the synagogues, and places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses, and for the sake of appearance, say long prayers. They will receive the great condemnation. He sat down opposite the treasury, and he watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then he called his disciples and he said to them, truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had. All she had to live on. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Together, friends, our centering prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, may your will be done through me. After my son's final water polo match of the season, the players from both teams, they formed these lines and they went through the ritual of congratulating each other as they walked by in that universal post-game athletic ceremony called the handshake line. And I was sitting in the stands with my youngest 5-year-old. He said, what are they doing? And I said, well, they're shaking hands. They do it after every match. The winning team, the losing team, they acknowledge their competition by shaking hands. Well, he said, why would they do that? The other team is the enemy. And I said, well, they shake hands to put, the game into perspective that the other team's not the enemy, they're just the opponent. And when all is said and done, they want to remember that they're friends. Oh, said the 5-year-old, I don't ever want to play water polo. And once again, out of the mouth of babes, we hear the words that adults won't say. It's hard after a well-fought and close and competitive matchup, which always tempts us to see the other side as the enemy and not the opponent, that we have a hard time going through the handshake line, that we show respect, that we are sportsmanlike. Of course, I'm talking about Tuesday's election, which is so much more than any game, so that for many people, it will take a long time to walk down that handshake line. There have been harsh words, there have been threats, there have been very coarse insults. People have been gravely offended. They have been lit up and ticked off. It took years, decades, for the U.S. to shake hands with Japan after World War II. Some people never did. Because we know that the deeper the investment, the wound, the harder, the longer it is to shake it off. And when that matchup is dealing with U.S. elections, which you remember basically start the day after the last one ended, it's a long game. It's a long time for us to form our opinions, to pass our judgments, to get grounded in our positions. We can't just flip a switch and adjust our attitudes. No, getting used to a new normal is not flipping a switch, is it? It's adjusting a dimmer. It's turning the dial, which some people will do quickly and others will do very slowly, if at all. And so we come to church. We come, some to deeply mourn, others to celebrate and to give thanks. And still others to do a bit of both because they're just happy it's over. And if you came to church to put these things into perspective, then you know that is what the church's job is to look for Jesus' perspective. It's to look to Jesus and his teaching, Jesus and his example. How did Jesus handle victory? How did Jesus handle defeat? How are we to make our way through uncharted waters about which some of us are excited and at peace and others are simply scared to death? I think we can get some clues from our gospel this morning as we consider what Jesus has to say about those hypocritical religious leaders and what he has to say about that impoverished woman with barely a cent to her name. Now, as you know, we're in the book of Mark. We've been in the book of Mark all year. We'll say goodbye at the end of the month when Advent comes and we take a look at Luke for the next year. But in this particular passage we have this morning, we have two stories that seem to be related, most likely didn't come one after the other from the original author. But nonetheless, Jesus begins with his teaching and he says, "Beware of the scribes." These are the religious leaders. They are men, and they are in a patriarchal society. They have respectable positions in that society. They have power. They have education. They have fancy clothes. They have plenty to eat. In the game of life, in that particular time and space, they are the winners. However, the scribes also have a problem, and that is that they are very poor at winning. They handle their favored position quite badly. They are selfish. They are prideful. They are cruel to widows, and they see themselves as entitled and as deserving. Life has given them so much, but they don't see it. They are bad winners, and they behave accordingly. After all, how are winners supposed to behave? Well, look at Jesus when Jesus won, following the resurrection and the biggest victory the world has ever known. Jesus had triumphed over death. He had obeyed his Father to the end. He had seen his body transform, and now he makes appearances to his disciples, to those who had followed him for 3 years, but in the end had betrayed and abandoned him. They were willing to go most of the way, but when the going got tough, they hit the road. When the authorities came to see Jesus and to see them in the Garden of Gethsemane, with their soldiers, with their swords, you all know the story, they took off. They left Jesus by himself to fend for himself. And what does Jesus do then, the winner, as he now confronts them in his resurrected body? There he is appearing. You remember the stories. They're behind a locked upper room. They're on the road to Emmaus. They're at the seaside making a fish breakfast. We notice Jesus, don't we? And how does Jesus behave when he sees those disciples? He does not gloat. He does not taunt. He does not rip into those disciples. What would you have said? Hey, where were you guys when I was getting abandoned and beaten? Jesus doesn't do any of that. He does not insult. He does not complain. He does not hold a grudge. In fact, do you remember his first words in every one of these instances? Peace be with you. Jesus is kind. Jesus is forgiving. The resurrected, winning Jesus is willing to put the past behind. As he urges them to get on with things, to keep at the mission that they have abandoned and they have failed. And now, having been treated like this, the winner was pretty nice to us. What do the disciples go and do? Well, they get on with reckless abandon at spreading Christianity, and it grows to a size and at a speed that no other world religion has ever matched. Friends, this is what winners do. They are kind. They are forgiving. They're willing to put the past behind, focused on the mission of shared well-being for all. If you consider Tuesday's election to be a win for you, then this snapshot of Jesus as a winner might be one to pay attention to. Don't gloat, don't taunt, don't be prideful or arrogant and entitled like the scribes. Be kind, be forgiving, be willing to put the past behind. If you've won, win like Jesus. Then, of course, we have that woman. We have that poor woman, that widow, meaning that her husband obviously had died, was no longer in the picture. And given the societal norms of the times, this suggests that this widow did not have many options by which to support herself, likely prostitution or begging. I'll take the amen, no matter how young. So this young woman, by prostitution or by begging, which obviously had not worked out well for her, she literally had a set to her name. She's poor, she's single, she's a woman. Three strikes, she's out, or on the outs, with no position, with no prestige, making her one of life's big losers. Yet in the midst of all that loss, look at how she behaves. But first, let's look at Jesus when he was in a similar position. Remember when Jesus had lost? It was after the disciples had abandoned and betrayed him. And he stood there homeless and haggard on the judgment seat before Pontius Pilate, the Roman authority, of course, who would decide his fate. And Pilate famously questioned Jesus, as you and I marvel at how this loser behaves. We notice that Jesus in front of Pilate, he's composed. He's got great composure. He doesn't insult. He doesn't berate. He doesn't complain to Pilate and say, the system's rigged. Why am I here? I don't deserve this. Jesus does not shake his fist at Pilate or at God. But Jesus' composure comes from his suspicion that God is not finished yet. Jesus is a man of faith. He knows he had done the right thing. He was doing the right thing. And that the God he serves is the real deal, who just may not be finished yet. We know Jesus had memorized many of the Psalms. Perhaps one of them was Psalm 146 that we just chanted. Perhaps it was running through Jesus' head as he stood there before Pilate. As Psalm 46 says, put not your trust in rulers, not in any child of the earth. Who keeps promises forever? Who gives justice to those who are oppressed? The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord cares for the stranger, sustains the orphan and widow, and frustrates the way of the wicked. If you are feeling lost today, following Tuesday's election, learn from Jesus. Have poise. Don't disparage. Don't insult. Don't berate. Don't complain. Have faith, put your trust in God when you consider that God is not finished yet. That you have not been abandoned. That the game is not over. Be like that loser, that penniless widow, and have faith that amidst the world's loss, God is here. God hasn't abandoned. God hasn't left the building. That widow had every reason to be bitter, to be selfish, to be angry at God and at the world. She had one penny to her name. But what did she do? She had faith. She went to church. She went to the temple. She didn't close God out. She opened her heart up. And she worshiped in the most profound way that human beings can worship. And that is what you guys do by coming here, by giving it all away. In the world's eyes, she was a loser. But not in God's eyes, who has immortalized her in this story. Perhaps in other ways we'll have to wait to discover. She was a winner in God's eyes. In the world's eyes, Jesus was a loser, but not in God's eyes. God raised him up to glory, giving him victory over death and the highest esteem one can imagine in this world and in the hereafter. So friends, no matter where you are this morning, following Tuesday's election, a big week of politics, let us have faith in the God who created, sustains, and provides for us, who invites humanity, invites humility when we win, and urges faith when we lose. And all along the way walks with us to the shining mountaintop and through the darkest valleys. James Baldwin suggests as much through one of my favorite poems, and I'll end with this, if you haven't heard it before. It's a poem called Some Days. Some days worry, some days glad. Some days more than make you mad. Some days more than shine when you see what's coming on down the line. Some days you say, oh, not me, never. Some days you say, bless God forever. Some days you say, curse God and die. And the day comes when you wrestle with that lie. Some days tussle, some days groan. Some days you hassle all alone. I don't know, sister, what I'm saying, nor do no man if he don't be praying. I know that love is the only answer, and the tightrope lover, the only dancer. When the lover comes off the rope today, the net which holds him is how we pray. And not to God's unknown, but to each other. The falling mortal is our brother. Some days leave, some days grieve. Some days you almost don't believe. Some days believe you, some days don't. Some days believe you, and you won't. Some days worry, some days mad. Some days more than make you glad. Some days more than shine. Witnesses coming on down the line. Amen. We believe in God, whose love is the source of all life and the desire of our lives, whose love was given a human face in Jesus of Nazareth, whose love is crucified by the evil that wants to enslave us all, and whose love, defeating even death, is our glorious promise of freedom. Therefore, though we are sometimes fearful and doubting, we trust in God, and in the name of Jesus Christ, we commit ourselves in the service of others to seek justice and to live in peace, to care for the earth and to share the commonwealth of God's goodness, to live in the freedom of forgiveness and in the power of the Spirit of love, and in the company of the faithful to be the church for the glory of God. Amen.
Bishops Justin, Sean, and Bonnie, and ministers Chris, Steve, and Felicity. Keep them in your ways and help them work together to serve your people. Let us pray to the Lord. Provided for Ruth in the face of her husband's death, we entrust our elected leaders to you, especially President Joe Biden, President-elect Donald Trump, all representatives and senators, Gretchen Whitmer, Governor of Michigan, and Ken Seiver, Mayor of Southfield. Let us pray to the Lord. Jesus, whose death betrayed your love, help us to serve others as you do, especially those who frequent our food pantry, our friends in Haiti, and those affected by gun violence. Let us pray to the Lord. The devotion of the widow and her two small copper coins. You also know the things we've been through this week that have confused and disturbed us. Regret, sorrow, and uneasiness have gripped us or someone we love. And we come as children seeking your solace. We ask you to meet us in our trouble. Let us pray silently or aloud for the people and problems in our life that we need to bring to you. Let us us pray to the Lord. Out of hypocrisy and pride to humility and faith. Be with us as we honor and remember those who have died, especially our veterans. Grant them a place in your kingdom and see that their work of self-denial and dedication is remembered. Feel free to name them silently or aloud. Let us pray to the Lord.
From our folks on Zoom, prayers for Ann Lisovich's friend Becky and her medical team, and from Lisa, a prayer request for David Mogul, Harold Brown, and Jackie Baker, who are all battling cancer.
And friends, may the peace of the Lord be always with you.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to St. David's. I am Alex Reinstra, one of your choir members and one of your vestry members. Come and join us for coffee and fellowship after church and to hear a presentation on medieval manuscripts with our parish musician, Al Evans. Al has been studying and collecting manuscripts for quite some time and offers us his wisdom and insight right after our 10 a.m. service. All are welcome. Coming up this week, we have been invited to the Chaldean Cultural Center in West Bloomfield for a museum visit and a luncheon. It's at the Shenandoah Country Club from 12 noon to 2 p.m. All are welcome, and it is free, but you do have to sign up at the Ministry Hub in the atrium first. Spaces are limited, so sign up right away. Then, next Sunday, we will be welcoming our new friends at St. David's at our 10 a.m. service. Each year we welcome those who have joined us in the last year with a festive liturgy and then a reception in the parish hall. Then, later that day, a special tea at the rector's house. If you plan on going, please sign up at the atrium or speak with one of our newcomer committee members. Also, if you have been a newcomer in the past but were unable to make it to the tea, you are welcome. Just make sure and sign up again at the atrium in Ministry Hub.
However, your tea will be cold.
We do what we can. And as we've mentioned, it is stewardship season. Our theme is to walk in love. We are charting our progress on the east wall. Each pledge brings us a step closer. Look at your stewardship packets in the mail. Pledge card gathering dates are November 10th, 17th, and 24th. I can't even begin to thank you for your contributions to St. David's. This parish has had an indescribably good effect on my life. You can also download the packet and the pledge card on our website. Just click the button on the home page.
And so, Alex, you know what we did when we put that heart there? See on the wall?
Mm-hmm.
We modeled it after yours.
Oh.
Because it was so great.
I need to check with the doctor.
But what you're going to see, yeah, check your doctor. What you're going to see is everybody who pledges gets a footstep. And so we're going to walk in love towards love there.
All right. And we hope you'll stay connected with us all week. If you're joining us online, please head to the St. David's website to sign our virtual guest book or follow the link if it's been put in the chat box. Those of you with a bulletin can scan the QR code on the back cover to sign our guest book. Also, you can subscribe to our podcast, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube channels. And if you're new with us, please stop by the Ministry Hub in the atrium. We want to give you a special gift and welcome you to our family. God bless you.
No joke today, Alex?
No joke today. I slept in.
He slept in. Okay, there you go.
A round of applause for Alex there.
I have a couple things for you for our offertory. First of all, let's see, Kathy Graham. Where's Kathy? Raise your hand, Kathy. Every year, Kathy helps us put together Thanksgiving baskets for those who need Thanksgiving baskets. So she needs, if you have somebody in your circle of friends who could use a Thanksgiving basket with fixings, a turkey, etc., see Kathy's by next week. Yeah, by next week, see Kathy. And then where's Jeannie? Jeannie, raise your hand. Jeannie's over here. She's looking for Sunday school teachers. Some of you may be called. Some of you may be called and don't know about it. But take it to your prayer closet because we could use you. It's relatively easy and harmless, and my kid at least doesn't bite, at least in church. So it should be pretty good. And a special thank you to Jessica and Steve Greenstra, because as you know, during stewardship season, we usually ask somebody to stand up and tell their stewardship story. We decided to make it a little bit more condensed, and so some people submitted to an on-camera video. So relax, take a few moments, and Steve, if you could roll the tape for Jessica and Steve.
The ministries that St. David's is involved in, and we want to be able to be a part of that and helpful in the ways that we're able to be.
Especially CSB and the Gun Buyback Program. It is so fun getting to destroy those guns. But CSB has been really good for our kids through the years.
Extra, you know, with our kids and everything, but we do feel it's important to give what we're able to be able to serve others and to be able to bless others with what we've been blessed with. Well, we're at a point in our lives where we don't.
Well, I enjoy assisting with ushering and obviously both CSB and the Gun Buyback Program as well. Jessica's done a lot with that on coordinating with the other churches to make it happen. All I do is show up and destroy the guns.
And able to, I don't feel like I have to hide, you know, any of those doubts that I might have when I'm here, but I feel like I can grow in my faith because I'm able to just be the person that I am, and I feel accepted and loved here.
And our kids too.
Yeah. Okay, for us, the inclusivity was a huge draw of the Episcopal Church, and that's why we originally wanted to try going to an Episcopal Church. We weren't raised Episcopalian, But you know, we felt strongly that we wanted a church that was inclusive of all people, you know, who are LGBTQ, different races, of any other like social or economic status. And it's important to us that we know that our family, you know, our children, our extended family and friends would all be welcome here at any time, regardless of where they came from or, you know, their position in life. Well, I think churches have a unique place in society where people feel like they can be helped here in a lot of different ways, and that's churches in general, not just St. David's, but you know, I know that a lot of people feel that St. David's plays a big part in them, in their lives, with our food pantry and with other things that we offer, and with being able to destroy guns that they don't want, and they don't know how else to get rid of them, things like that. And then as well as spiritually offering various services and Bible studies and so forth for people that want to grow more in their spiritual life. I feel like we are able to help with those physical practical needs as well as the spiritual.
And CSB is a really good ministry in this time where so many kids don't have anywhere other than home and school to be, because just the changes in society have meant that people don't go out to the parks as much. They don't go out to and meet other people in other places so much, where the CSB gives a really welcoming to all place for kids who are like, Boy Scouts is too much of a commitment. But I can do once a week, or at least once most weeks, as the case may be. And the kids just love going out camping and all those other things that we get to do together, where if your parents don't camp, your chances of camping are pretty much nil otherwise. It's more for me continuing supporting it than growing. I think it might just be a phase of life thing for me where keeping the fire, but not burning any hotter or differently at this point.
For me, yeah, it's just, I appreciate hearing the messages from the perspective of the Episcopal Church, and like learning more about my faith, and why I do believe the way I do, and not, again, not being afraid to like explore those questions and concerns that you might have about faith in general and religion.
And one of the things the Episcopal Church, I think, stresses really well is the unity of the church. Oh yeah, it's part of who we are at this point.
Okay. You can clap. Jessica's back.
Standing ovation there from a supporter there. So anyway, you guys have your pledge stuff coming your way. Now is our offertory. For those of you giving online, you can go to our website, you can click the donate button. And for those of you giving here, thank you. Thank you very much. This is the last Sunday we'll have the guns up here. But we wanted to do it on the last Sunday that we did that, after a big summer of really extraordinary work. And I hope you come to the presentation in a few weeks to see how much of a mark your community has made and your support for this community has made in gun safety in our area and perhaps even farther. So let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice unto God.
God of mercy and judgment, we rejoice to give you thanks and praise. Or like the widow who put into the temple treasury 2 copper coins, which were all she had, you give to us your very hearts in the flesh and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. For he is our
great high priest, who once for all removed sin by his sacrifice himself.
He entered into heaven and he appeared in your presence on our behalf. Having been offered once to bear the sins of many, he will appear a second time to save those who are eagerly waiting for him. And so with all the company of heaven, we gladly sing the praise of your glory.
Thank you.
faith with thanksgiving.
Oh,
it all. Do not slave for things that are not life-giving, but trust in God's provision and give generously of all that you have. And may God watch over you and provide for you. May Christ Jesus be to you a restorer of life, and may the Holy Spirit lead you in the ways of humble generosity.